We will be circulating a synopsis of that. Now, I've just been doing a little bit of housekeeping. They haven't told me that there were going to be any fire alarms. We did have a test one yesterday, which was really not that exciting. But anyway, if there is a fire alarm, it means that it's real, and would be grateful if you could kindly leave the building. And we're not congregating anywhere, so please just take your things and leave. There's no smoking in the building. I don't believe there's smoking in the courtyard too, I'm not sure. But there's loads of BMA staff here that you can ask. And we're going to be finishing at 1, but what's happening is we're having a series of presentations. We'll be having a presentation by the Special Assistant to the Honourable Minister of Industry, Trade and Investment, who's representing the Ministry of Industry, Trade and Investments. This will be followed by a presentation by the Chair of the NBCC UK, Mr. James Houston, and then we'll also have a presentation from Mr. Chris Gunning of Intertech, who are a total quality assurance provider. The onus of today is about the ease of doing business in Nigeria, and we really want to create some discussion and Q&A. So after the presentations, we will be encouraging you all to please ask questions and share some of your experiences so that we can learn from each other. This is a very nice sized group, and if we finish at around about 11:30, 12 o'clock, that will allow us to have space for quite some good networking. And as I said, if you would like to have a one-to-one session with any of our mission delegates, please do let me know. Now, before we start the presentations, I think this is a really good opportunity to introduce you to the delegation that have come here from Nigeria to meet with you. So I'm going to ask, in no particular order, please, if individuals could stand up. I think we'll start with the president, actually, in no particular order. I saw you, CV, so okay. So we'll start with the president of the Nigerian British Chamber of Commerce. Thank you very much, sir.
My name is Dapo. Thank you.
Oh, sorry, sir. And also your business interest and your concerns for the Nigerian British Chamber of Commerce. Thank you.
Well, I'm the president of the chamber and I'm the leader of the delegation.
And the deputy. Thank you. If you can introduce yourself, your business interest, and if you've got anything you'd like to say about the chamber.
Oh, I see.
Thank you.
Okay. And the Nigerians alike to know that it is not all that you read that is true. And also true, like we said yesterday, it's also very important for you to come and feel the country directly yourself. We have told you all that it's happening. You need to come and take advantage. You are better off taking it when the wind is as strong. Thank you.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Kyle Ifalo. I am CEO of Greenwich Trust, based in Lagos. Greenwich is an investment banking firm. I'm also a council member of the Nigeria British Chamber of Commerce, and I head the Advocacy, Investment and Mobilization Committee of the council. So, my job in the council is to ensure that you all come and invest your money in Nigeria. In fact, the reasons why you should from the other day yesterday, you heard partly also from the minister, and I believe you'll hear more from the representative of the Minister for Trade and Investment. So you are welcome.
Good morning. My name is Bisi Adeyemi. I'm the Managing Director of DCS and Corporate Services, which used to be a Deloitte entity. I'm also Treasurer of the MPCC. My company is a professional services firm. We assist companies to set up in Nigeria. We also provide governance and training services. As Treasurer of the MPCC, of course, you know what my remit is. Thank you.
Good morning, my name is Joy Okwadigo. I was the regional director for Africa Ivory College, Portsmouth UK, and the chairman of the Learning, Education and Training Committee of the Nigerian British Chamber. back to the UK on the 2nd of May, not that I've ever left the UK. So we are passionate about training the best of British education, technical vocational education in Nigeria. I'm still working with Highland College as a friend, and I'll remain a critical friend as a member of the Nigerian British Chamber of Commerce. We have 120%, if it's possible, of UK High Commissioner support for the Nigerian British Chamber of Commerce. And as a member of the Council, the Nigerian British Chamber of Commerce, these are fantastic, honorable people, and I want to be flying the UK flag, working with the Nigerian British Chamber of Commerce and the UK network.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Teresa Amai. I'm the Vice President of Nigerian British Chamber of Commerce, and I'm in charge of the branch development. Once we have a lot of people somewhere in any area that are interested in the Nigerian British Chamber of Commerce, we open up a branch, and then they become part of us. I'm also, I have two caps in my head. I have an into telecommunication, as well as tourism. The telecommunication company is based in Nigeria and also in United States. We have so many equity from the United States, and we are here. I'm here also to see how we can partner with people who technically and also financially. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Chilama Bruce, my name. I'm the CEO of Resta Express PLC Nigeria. Resta holds the franchise for both FedEx and TNT, and we have other businesses in the arena of warehousing, logistics, and transportation. I'd be glad to do business with you. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Elizabeth Olawori. I'm director in Brokerfield Real Estate Services and Interior Design. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Mr. Ibe. I'm the CEO of Cardinal Security Services Limited. I will have five locations in Nigeria and also four other locations in East and West Africa. At the moment, we're trying to set up a theme park in Nigeria, one of its kind, in Lagos location. The land is available, but we're looking for possible interest investors in that respect.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Alice, Alice Monta. I work for the Department for International Trade. We support UK businesses to expand internationally, and we also encourage foreign companies to set up in the UK as well. I'm here just to network and to try to understand more of the climate in Nigeria in regards to trade and investment. So, thank you very much.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Yasmin Sembeli, and I'm the director of Riverbrook Ventures Limited. My main interests are exporting food from Nigerian food into the UK, but I'm also into property. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Nia Jani. I'm into real estate. I'm the chief salesman, founder of InCity Property Limited. We more of the property investment side of things. We try to, Nigerians who are looking to invest back home, who are living in the UK and try to invest back home. Agriculture as well. I run a farm in Nigeria and do export into UK as well. And I'm always looking for companies who are looking to invest back home. I live here, but I like to work with companies who are looking to invest back home as well. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My name's Ed Hovey. I'm a senior analyst with Africa Risk Consulting. We provide integrity, due diligence, and political risk services for companies based both in the UK and in Africa who are looking to do business in Africa.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Mr. Ademola, CEO for the South Energy Resources, which is a family office of the Proper Company Development in UK and West. currently we are penetrating the area for power and vegetable oil. So we've already incorporated the company and that's why we're here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Tunde Obune. I'm the managing partner of Unicorn Associates in Lagos. We are into engineering and infrastructural consultancy services. I'm on the Council of the United Chamber of Commerce, and I chair the membership committee. Our major assignment there can be summarized as ensuring good quality membership and prosperity for the membership of the Chamber of Commerce. Thank you.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Basunde Bello. I'm the council member of the Egyptian Commerce. I'm a business development consultant. We try to the capacity of Nigerian MSMEs and link them up with their foreign counterparts in the area of capacity building, project execution, and funding. We also consult for a number of donor agencies in Nigeria, UNDP, World Bank, and European Union. We are here to look for Nigerian and British companies that are interested invest in Nigeria and also to interested in conducting surveys in Nigeria. Thank you very much.
Good morning, everybody. My name is David Carew. I'm the CEO and founder of Energy Markets International. I've been working in Nigeria for 10 years, so a lot of experience working in pretty much all the industries from power, oil and gas. Quite a bit of work for like Dora Akinwunmi on media and internet out there. So there's a wealth of experience in there for anybody thinking of going to Nigeria. I can certainly tell them where I went wrong and where I went right.
Good morning, my name is Albi Lamash. I have a sore throat. I work for Central Water. I manage intellectual property for Central Water. So in terms of my interests, well, if you talk about intellectual property today at any point, I'll be interested. Otherwise, I'll just listen in. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Rebecca Ellis. I'm from Pomona Wealth. We're an investment advisory firm. I'm one of the managing partners. We're active in the West Africa market, so I'm very interested to understand what's going on in the current climate and look at the opportunities available.
Morning, everyone. My name is Trevor Ford. I'm from a company called Teton Relocations. We help companies to transfer their staff internationally. The entire process, we're already active in Nigeria, and we're very strong in the oil and gas and financial services sector.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Christina Oshodi. My interests are within the field of sports, in particular football. I work for the Football Association in this country and very interested in doing some work back home.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Hilary Marcus and I'm one of the founders of a company called Pan Eco Synergy. We currently are very active in the commodities market. We broker between farmers as well as international buyers. We also work in the capacity of raising finance for local businesses over in West Africa. I'm quite interested in speaking to every single person here. God bless you.
Hi, good morning. My name is Oni Anyado, founder of OA Media House. I'm involved in leadership development and corporate development. So my interest is to go to Nigeria to develop programs for young people in particular to rise up in leadership. So leadership development. Thank you.
Morning, everyone. My name is Jeannie Adingle. I'm an IT professional. I specialize in IT operations and digital forensics cybersecurity. I'm here for networking and also to seek opportunities for education, IT training, and development, as well as other property and investment opportunities. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Eric Manny. I'm the director of Ian Brokerage. We're based in the UK. We try to back into the Nigerian market because investments. We work on real estate, we do development, we do off-plan. We've got currently 6 properties that we're working on. I'm from Bawa Ken to Chatham. So if you want to get in touch, please let me know. Thank you.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Christopher Gunning. You're going to hear from me in a little while, but I work for a company called Intertech, and we help importers and exporters of goods into Nigeria. But I won't bore you now. I'll bore you in about 20 minutes' time.
Good morning. My name is Ranjit Gunawardner, Chairman of International Consultants. We are lenders at some of my clients, and that's the reason that I'm here to see if there are any projects which we can look into.
Good morning, everyone. A special thank you to the Nigerian UK Chamber of Commerce. From the bottom of my heart, your team have been doing a very great job representing Nigeria. Thank you so much. We are a UK-based company, and what we do is we help governments and leading companies put projects together to bring it into bankability. We know people, we have access to companies that can help turn things around quickly. We love partnership. Thank you.
It's the Nigerian British Chamber of Commerce. Thank you.
Good morning to everybody. My name is Denis Hazel, and my interest is water treatment, and I would like to penetrate to Nigerian market, and I would like to hear some information what to do and how to do it. That's all.
My name is Vivian Chimezi Azubike. I'm the Acting Director General of Nigerian British Chamber of Commerce. The Nigerian British Chamber of Commerce is a platform where businesses meet, and our major objective is to promote businesses and trade between Nigeria and the UK. So please feel free to contact me. I'm like a one-stop shop for you to, you know, get to understand what business is all about in Nigeria. And I can give you my information. Just let me know. Thank you.
That was fantastic. Thank you very much. And, and I'm sure incredibly valuable. Oh, my goodness.
We'll take your video.
There you go. Can you film yourself?
Okay, my name is Olayomi Koike from Niger Diaspora. It's the one center of connecting the Nigeria together, both here in UK and diaspora, back in UK and Nigeria, and the business development. And this has been live stream on Facebook. Check it out, probably a few questions.
Thank you very much. So, as I was saying, I think that was an incredibly valuable, I'm very excited to start to talk to people individually as well during the networking and one-to-one sessions. So just to remind you of the order of today, we're going to have 3 presentations, after which we'll invite them to take Q&A, and the Q&A will form a Q&A style discussion. So I feel that there is an opportunity here that if there is a question that has been posed and you feel that you have an answer or a follow-up question, then please feel free. I'll facilitate it, but let's try and have a dynamic conversation, because ease of doing business in Nigeria is tangible, but I think there's a lot of ideas in the room that we would like to gather so that we can make it even easier. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce our first speaker, who is Mr. Emeka Efezunike. He's the Special Assistant to the Honourable Minister of Industry, Trade and Investment in Nigeria, and will be representing the Ministry in this presentation. Thank you very much.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Emeka Efezunike. I joined you guys yesterday. I flew in from Lagos overnight. And then I came out from my retirement. Actually sat at the back and I do stuff. And I thought I was going to fall when she punched to me. I suddenly became awake. Greetings from the Honourable Minister, Dr. Okechukwu Enelama. And let me tell you the first story that, you know, impacts on this. The Minister, I've known him for quite some time, and both of us have worked on various projects in the past. And when he was nominated to be Minister, initially we thought he was going to be Minister of Finance or stuff like that, because he did investment banking and all that. But then suddenly, he was made the Minister for Industry, Trade and Investment. And the very first thing he told me was, Emeka, we need to address the ease of doing business in Nigeria. We need to create an enabling environment for doing business in Nigeria. And that I had a personal experience in. I knew this because I'm what they call a chartered accountant and a CPA from America, and I practiced in Nigeria for quite some time. And I had worked with investors who came from abroad. And I had one experience that I can never forget. I had this chap, let me just call him Frank, because that's his first name. Frank came into Nigeria after a long time of trading with Nigerian clients. He came into Nigeria and he used to bring in equipment for manufacturing for a lot of the small and medium scale industries in Nigeria. He visited various parts of Nigeria, supplying equipment, installing them, and quite a lot of small industries were growing up as a result of Frank's work in Nigeria. One day Frank invited me to his office and told me he had discovered something very strange. So I said, what? He said he just came back from Thailand, where he had gone to visit his customers, and he found out that the biggest business, the biggest money-making venture in Nigeria was rice. And I said, Frank, this is very dangerous. Frank said, no, Emeka, this is good. He did the numbers for me. The numbers all added up. Rice was bigger than equipment or machineries. Like, rice was the biggest thing ever. So Frank said, Emeka, how do I get into rice? And I said, no problem, go import the stuff. He said, no, I want to know how to sell. And at the same time, at that time I run a practice, an accounting firm. So I had, as one of my clients, one of the biggest distributors of rice in Nigeria. So I invited her, and she had a meeting with Frank. And it was agreed that everything Frank brings in, she can sell. The numbers were agreed, the prices were agreed. So Frank imported his first shipload of rice into Nigeria. Overnight, 3 a.m. exactly, Frank called me. And I was like, what's wrong? I said, Frank called me. I said, Mecca, what is happening? I said, what's the matter with you? What's the problem? He said, people were carrying pallets of his rice and dumping right into the sea. And I woke up and I said, Frank, this is not true. What's happened? Who have you talked to? Who are you dealing with? He said, Mecca, as I'm talking to you, this happened all yesterday. I'm almost losing everything I brought in. So I woke up and very early in the morning, I was in Frank's house and we had to go and talk to people at the Port Authority and all that. And some fellow told Frank, you got it wrong. We need to give you the right man to clear your goods. So a meeting was arranged between Frank and this gentleman, and it looked as if everything was sorted out. And Frank was happy. Money was rolling in. 2 years down the line, Frank called me and said, look, he's really sick and tired of this trading thing. He wanted to set up a plant to manufacture all kinds of goods, you know, mineral water and all that, which was a brilliant idea. That's what I wanted. So we went on, went to NIPC and got our permits, got everything, and we set up massive plants, wonderful plants. And Frank started producing. He borrowed money from the bank, First Bank, Zenith Bank, you know, a few other banks. He borrowed money from them, and everything seemed to be working fine. I had one other experience with him. Frank felt it was important for him to get, at that time, our head of state was General Obasanjo, excellent man. Frank wanted to get to him. He wanted to get to the president's, you know, get to the top, to see the people at the top, because he felt that was the right thing to do. So we started navigating that, and Frank said he had an information that if you donated one some things to the presidency, things were going to work for you. And I told Frank, everything you're doing so far looks good, so let's not even go on this route. Down the line, somebody told Frank, come and make some donations to the presidency, and you know, everything will be fine. So Frank called me, and we had access right into the villa. As we were getting to the villa, when we got to the gate, they normally will stop you at the gate and take all your bags. And Frank had some serious money in foreign currency, and he was like, America, I need to take some of this money with me just in case. And I said, Frank, this is the seat of government. This is our president's house. Don't even try it. Don't disgrace me. And Frank said, okay. We left everything and we drove it. We got there and we met some officials. And they said, oh, they liked all the Frank's products. Everything was working fine. And then somebody started talking. Oh, they needed money desperately. They whined, they whined, they complained. And Frank was looking at me. And I was like, don't do it. The person went on and went on, up and down. And Frank said, look, they took my bag at the gate. And the person said, no, we called them at the gate, they will bring it back. So they brought the bag, and that's it, it happened. 2 years down the line, Frank's business was booming, as it were. One day, at that time, let me just give you a background. I was made a founding member of the Economic and Financial Crimes Commission, where the people that started EFCC. So down the line, we had no clue that this fellow that Frank got to sort out his pot problems was apparently not even paying duties. I mean, Frank was paying him, but he wasn't paying any duties, and he was, you know, things were happening and he got the stuff in. So after some time, the same fellow started blackmailing him. And then I had no clue this was happening. And one day I got to his office and Frank told me, look, he's in trouble. I said, what's the matter? He said, this man is blackmailing him. I said, what's the matter? So let's report this matter to the commission. I'm a member of the board, we can sort it out. Frank said, it's not so straightforward. Because apparently there's evidence that duties haven't been paid. And suddenly, a petition came to the EFCC on this matter. The amount of money that was involved was humongous. The banks were being owed money. The factory was, you know, thrown up. Overnight, Frank came to me and said, in fact, on an evening, my office came to my office and said, America, how do we get all these problems to go away? And I told him, the right thing to do for you, Frank, is to tell the truth. Tell your story, tell the truth. If the commission says you must go to jail, then go to jail. If you have to pay back, you will pay back. That same night, Frank ran away from Nigeria. I mean, this is life story, true life story. Frank took off. So what the minister told me, the key thing is to get that environment right. That there was no other way we can move business forward in Nigeria if we don't get the environment right. I also recall one occasion we traveled to Norway with the past president, and we had a breakfast meeting of gentlemen like these, of various investors. And I remember a guy, a Norwegian guy, he got up and asked the president, that was the president of Basenjo then, he asked him, he said, why would I want to come and do business in Nigeria? I have two options. I can either go to Qatar and set up my plants, or come to Nigeria to set up my plants. In Nigeria, these are the issues I'm going to face. No power, no water, no this, no that, no that. But in Qatar, give it. So why would I? And the president was like, what can we do? We're trying to get these things right. The one thing I can tell you is that the determination of this government to get it right is unparalleled. One of the joys of the minister today is that when he went to the president and said this was critical to get the environment right, he said he couldn't believe it. He came back that day and called me and said, Mecca, the president bought it. The president is happy about it. And the president decided to set up the presidential environment, ease of doing business office, right in the presidential office, with the vice president as the chairman. And that will tell you how committed this government is to put an end to all that rubbish that was taking place in the past. And that's why I can tell you with all of my heart that by 2019, everybody will be begging to come to Nigeria. Because that determination is there. By 2019, everybody. Right now, I mean, it's easy for say, okay, World Bank rated us 169 and all that, we haven't moved far, but we are not talking anymore. The PEBEC office has decided these are action plans we are going to take. These are the things we need to do. And on a monthly basis, at the presidency level, the PEBEC is subjected to review. What have you done? Action, real action. What have you done in this area? How easy is it for us to incorporate companies? How easy is it for us to get licenses? All those things have been dealt with in a very clear manner. And results are showing even right now. So I'm going to talk briefly about PEBEC and preliminary reforms, institutional reforms, and I'll just conclude for you. But for me, the story I've just told you is what was in the past, and what I'm telling you right now is the things that have. I mean, it's not as if we don't know. I know. We have experienced this. It's not good for investors. It's not good for Nigerians. And nobody lives with something that is wrong. It's not something that we are so passionate about that unless we get it right, it's not even good for us. We want to move on this ease of business index. We want to move into the top 50 within the next 10 years. I mean, we're being realistic, it's not going to happen overnight, but we will do it. And, I mean, this is futuristic, right? This is futuristic. We're saying, this is the kind of story that will be told about Nigeria 2019. We're going to be Africa's success story. The Enabling Environment Initiative has been approved by government and it has started work making its initial aspiration a reality. The effort is not just about the ease of doing business, right, but general improvement to the business and operating environment. As I told you, the reporting format is the Secretariat will report to the Council and then they'll be reporting to the Federal Executive Council. This is being addressed at the very top of government, and this is not talk show, this is not talk. This is action. This is something we have seen real. The PEVEC has actually just concluded an action plan committing to a clear set of desired outcomes for each reform area. Starting a business, more convenient, fully online application process, elimination of the need to hire a lawyer, the number of days required to register business reduced from 10 to 2. Construction permits, published laws and fees on website, operationalized e-planning platform, clearer application of regulations and requirements, soil tests and all that. Getting electricity, reduction in procedures required to get connected to the grid, reduction in time to get connected in Lagos and Kano, starting with two of the 11 distribution companies in the electricity sector. Registering property, simplification of application process, for example, by eliminating sworn affidavits, reduction in time to obtain governor's consent by 50%. Getting credit, passage of two bills, collateral registry and credit bureau to strengthen legal framework. Facilitation of improved credit scoring and assets for MSMEs, paying taxes, removal of in-person requirement for tax identification numbers with company registration, e-filing and e-payment processes to improve tax adherence and ease of payment, trading across border world standard guidelines on the import procedures, 50% reduction in import and export times and driven by streamlined examination processes. Entry and exit of people, 48-hour visa processing timeline across missions abroad. Simplification of visa on arrival, fixed infrastructural deficits at Nigerian airports. This has been largely implemented by over 70%. One of the things that the minister said the first time he came to office, he said, won't it be nice, won't it be just excellent if you walk into a government office and the man gets off his seat, comes across to him and say, how can I help you? Just how can I help you to achieve what you want? And this has started happening. That's why the minister takes the Nigerian British Chamber of Commerce very important. I flew in simply because of this. We want to work with you. We want to work with you. Nigeria is going to be driven by private sector. We are desperate. How did Yawande put it yesterday? Something about capital. There was something she said, how we treat capital. Haunted. Yes. We want to cut capital, please. We want to. We are desperate to work with you. The days of looking at capital as, you know, we don't want to think about it anymore. We want to work with you. We know, we recognize the power of private capital. We recognize the power of private investors. Information, I mean, we want to be clearly transparent. Information about government requirements for products and services will be easily accessible by the public online and in public places. And this is to ensure complete clarity on government requirements for obtaining products and services. We need to make sure that applications for government approvals are processed in accordance with timeline communicated to the public. I mean, if you've been listening to the news, the acting president has come up with a presidential order on this, clearly, to every government department. To every government department. There has to be clarity. And if you make an application and you don't get a no in the time frame, it's assumed you've gotten it through. We want to move away from the days of faffing around and just creating a room for corruption. We want to put an end to all that. We want to ensure the communication of approval or rejection of applications in stipulated time. Documents issued by the MDA to private can be accessed by other MDAs. We don't want to get into, government ministries, departments, and agencies were operating in silos. You find that one department had to apply to another. I mean, we are one government. And that's what we are, one government. When you say this is the government of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, that's what it is. We want to publish a complete list of all requirements, conditions for obtaining products and services within the MBA's scope of responsibility, including all fees, timelines. In the past, people used to come to Nigeria and they were almost like groping in the dark. And all kinds of people will tell you 1,001 things, different things that you needed to do. We want to put an end to all that. We have put an end to all that. Conspicuously pasted on the premises of the Reverend MDA and published on his website. Responsibility for the head of the Reverend MDA to ensure that the list is verified and kept up to date at all times. Within 21 days, you know, we have set all this in motion. There's a presidential order on this. Communicate approval or rejection of an application within the timeline stipulated in the published list. All applications for business registrations, certification, waivers, and licenses or permits, or the applications shall be deemed approved and granted as stated in published requirements. Applicant whose application is deemed granted under this directive may apply to the minister for the time being in charge of the application for the issuance of any document or certificate in evidence of the grant within 14 days. Lapse of the NDS stipulated timeline for application. This means that if you have applied and the timeline is for 2 days and you don't get it, you assume that it is granted, and you apply that by writing to the minister, he said it's granted. So if they refuse you, they have a right. They are commanded by law to get back to you and say, this is why we have. Failure of the appropriate officer to act on any application within the timeline stipulated without lawful excuse shall be amount to misconduct and be subject to appropriate disciplinary proceedings. As I said, it's one government. NDA shall no longer require a private applicant to produce or submit a document issued to it by the federal government as part of an application process. I mean, you go to places and they ask you, bring tax there, bring this and bring, and it's all one government. You know, want to put an end to that, just to make it easier for you to operate in the system. NDAs are requiring input documentation, requirements or conditions from another NDA in order to deliver products and services on application within the originating NDA's remit or mandate, shall only request a photocopy or other prima facie proof from the applicant. It shall be responsibility of the original NDA to seek verification of certification necessary from the issuing NDA. Failure of this appropriate officer to act on any of the application within the timeline stipulated without lawful excuse shall amount to misconduct and be subject to appropriate disciplinary proceedings. We know that it's been difficult for investors, diaspora. Everybody thinks port of entry is a tough place. But when we put an end to that, we truly have put an end to that. So entry experience for visitors and travelers, ordinary tourists and business entry visas to Nigeria shall henceforth be issued or rejected with reason by the Consular Office of Nigerian Embassies and High Commission within 48 hours of receipt of valid application. There's a presidential order on this. A comprehensive and up-to-date list of requirements, conditions, and procedure for obtaining visa on arrival, including estimated time frame, shall be published on all immigration-related websites in Nigeria and abroad, including embassies and high commissions and all ports of entry into Nigeria. The timing is immediately after a directive is signed. This has already gone into started. Visa on arrival shall be granted at all Nigerian ports or entry once applicants have met all the published requirements. Port operations. I mean, this was something that I wish was in place by the time my friend Frank was in Nigeria. There shall be no touting whatever by official or unofficial persons at any port in Nigeria, and all unofficial staff shall be removed from the secured area of airports. Any official court soliciting or receiving bribes from passengers or other port users shall be subject to immediate removal from the post and disciplinary, as well as criminal proceedings in line with extant laws and regulations. Merge respective departure and arrival interfaces at the airport into a single customer interface within 30 days without prejudice to necessary back-end procedures. Harmonize operations of all NDAs physically present at the port into one single interface station domiciled in one location in the port and implemented by a single joint task force at all times without prejudice to necessary back-end procedures within 60 days. The experience that people go and you have all kinds of people in different uniforms coming at you. I want to put an end to this. You arrive, I mean, everything will be domiciled in one office and you get direct interface with them from one officer. Assign an existing export terminal to be dedicated to the exportation of commercial produce within 30 days of the issuance of this directive. A proper port shall resume 24-hour operations within the next 30 days. This has been put in place through the presidential order. Registration of businesses, all registration processes at the CSC are fully automated through the CSC website from the start of an application process to completion. And this also has already commenced. Nigeria is operating business environment is not unique. We have a great opportunity to foster the right enabling environment to deliver on Nigeria of our dreams. The task of improving and operating business environment requires continuous improvement, joint ownership and better coordination, and increased collaboration between NDAs and the keys to achieving our objectives. Everyone in Nigeria, all the NDAs, all the people operating, is in one unique voice on this. And I'm giving you my word. I'm trying to be extremely honest about this. It's a game changer. Things have changed. I will ask NBCC. You can take my telephone number. I don't have two, just one. You can reach me anytime. The minister too is easily to be reached anytime. We give you a word. The environment for doing business in Nigeria is good. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Please, another round of applause. And I think that this is an opportunity to definitely test that. The Nigerian British Chamber of Commerce, for obvious reasons, we're here to support businesses who want to do bilateral trade, so UK-based businesses. You can be in touch with us to support you in terms of setting up your own company, finding out a little bit more about some of the registration certificates that you need. So please do get in touch with us. Let's test the Nigerian government. And I think that we'll send you the presentation and obviously the contact details. And we would be very interested in your experiences and also your ideas and maybe some of the concerns you may have. Anyway, so our next speaker is Mr. James Houston, who is the chair of the Nigerian British Chamber of Commerce UK Network. I'm just going to put his presentation up. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Amika, for that very instructive presentation. And it really... It links with my own presentation. This year is the 40th anniversary of NBCC in Nigeria. I found it quite some time ago. The UK network is much more recent. We really drew our impetus in more recent years from the Export Britain initiative of a few years ago. I'm conscious I'm talking to two segments in the room. One is a delegation from Nigeria, and one is business people that reside in the UK. And the few slides I'm going to show you today are those, or it's a distillation of some presentations I've done in earlier events, and it's addressed as a UK perspective of doing trade and promoting investment with Nigeria, and indeed Africa, generally. Last week, for instance, we participated in an event called Going Global at Exol in London. This was actually a Pan-African event, and NBCC participated in it. We had three of our members on one single stand. One of them's here today, Chris Gunning, will talk to you in a bit more detail. But what that event sought was to provide a cohesive set of services to UK companies, exporters in particular, who want to trade with Nigeria and Africa generally. So we had Intertech, a company called Synergy in Trade, which specializes in trade finance, Velta, which is a freight forwarder company, and the Travel Visa Company. And we've just heard a little bit about the new visa regime in Nigeria. It certainly has been a challenge in the past in visas, and certainly one of our members is competent to help British companies in this area. Just to talk briefly about trade finance, those of you who are in the UK will know that it's not always easy to procure trade finance for exports, certainly for a continent like Africa. Some of the larger banks in the UK have not been particularly open to that. So we have at least one of our UK members that specialises in Africa, and actually tell us that they've never had a default in Nigeria. So that is good news. So. Just one other piece of information to help British companies become a little bit more engaged with Nigeria. And just to say that these events in London and elsewhere work, we met a company called Qatar Steel last week, came to our stand. They were here yesterday. Qatar, you wouldn't perhaps associate with steel production, but in this particular case, they're quite interested in engaging with Nigeria. So that's one introduction we will be following up. And one or two other companies came to see us. Healthcare is one such example. Now, just talking about sub-Saharan Africa generally, we can say that there are 30 years of sustained growth going through to 2030 above 5%. There are very few other parts of the world we can say that. 6 out of 10 of the world's fastest growing economies are in Africa, and the next 40 years, half of the world's population increase will come from Africa. And Africa's consumer-facing industry is expected to grow by more than £260 billion. This is a list of some of the countries in Africa population. Africa's got 54 countries, a third of whom, 18, are actually in the Commonwealth. This is relevant to our current debate on Brexit. Brexit, we hope, or I hope, certainly it will become a game changer in terms of people's perspective on trade with Africa. Those of us who have to deal with the British government, I think it would be true to say a bit disappointed by the lack of information the British government offers about Africa. Indeed, it's not just Africa, there are parts of the world like South America. So we think Brexit itself will be quite a game changer. And we hope, as NBCC, to play our part in introducing companies into Nigeria. But you can see from that slide there, Nigeria is by far the most populous country in Africa, more than three times the size of population of its next largest country, which is South Africa. So it punches above its weight in terms of population. Now, I put this slide up when I'm doing events in the UK because, perhaps necessarily so, there is a lack of information about Nigeria. People don't appreciate its size. And as you can see here, we've got a chart that shows the 6 socio-economic regions, 36 self-governing states, Abuja, the administrative and legislative capital, Lagos, the commercial centre. And I tend to talk these presentations a little bit about the history of Nigeria, the civil war, and there's still some legacy issues from that, but also just to emphasize that Nigeria is a complex country, several hundred linguistic groups. It's wise not to generalize about Nigeria, but it's just its size. We need to communicate that to the UK companies. Africa is more than 5,000 miles north to south, east to west. Nigeria is obviously a fraction of that size. But even Nigeria, people worry about Boko Haram. And I have to point out in these events that Boko Haram is in the northeast tip of Nigeria. And it doesn't really impact on the rest of Nigeria, particularly in areas like Lagos in the southwest. Just a couple of points about Nigerians in the diaspora. People perhaps forget the influence the diaspora has around the world. Looking at Nigeria, it's interesting to note that United States, Nigerians, the remittance inflows to Nigeria is $6.1 billion per year. Fairly close second, United Kingdom is $3.8 billion. So there's a large sums of money flowing from the diaspora back to the countries of origin. And also for those involved in education, it's interesting to note that in the UK, the Nigerian student population is the third largest after China and India. There's something like 18,000 Nigerian students in the UK. There's not many universities in the UK that do not have Nigerian students. And when you consider, let's say, each of those students is spending something like £20,000 a year, It's very big businesses, very big business to UK universities. Hence, those of us who hope we will have a sensible Brexit, we want to make sure our educational sector is not adversely affected, and that countries like Nigeria will continue to send students here. Nigeria's trade with the UK, that's a fairly straightforward slide. The larger percentage is in the machinery, transport, equipment and commodities, which is not entirely surprising when you consider the oil and gas sector. There are quite a few British companies engage with the oil and gas sector, hence the quite large percentage figure you'll see there.
The next couple of slides I credit to our colleague Colette Coyote for the Lower Greenwich Trust, who's here today. These were prepared for an event at the end of the autumn 2016. They're not quite up to date, but they give a little bit of a picture of Nigeria's economy. Many of you will know that there was a fourth quarter drop in GDP in Nigeria, but we can look forward with some optimism in the future. I put this slide up for those British companies who engage with the Nigerian government because it just gives you a bit of a picture of how the Nigerian government is spending its money. So this happens to be the 2016 budget allocations for government. And you can see the Ministry of Works spending 35%, Transportation 16%, Defence 11%, Interior 4%, and last but not least, Ministry of Agriculture. Now, considering agriculture engages a larger percentage of Nigeria's population, the amount that the government is spending is relatively low, but we know that the Nigerian government is looking for investment in the agricultural sector in supply chains. So let us hope these investors do engage more fully with the country. Now, Echo Bank, we participate, as you may see also, circulars from investment banks to do with economic activity in Africa. I read the Echo Bank ones regularly because they're quite helpful to us in the UK to get a picture of what's happening in Africa generally. This is March, it's a little while ago, but it is indicative of what's happening. Monetary policy rate was held at 14%. Inflation slowed in February 2017, but at 17.8% it's above the Central Bank Nigeria target of 6-9%, and real GDP is negative, contracted in quarter four 2016. However, the Central Bank expects output to recover this year. There are, of course, challenges from lower oil prices and protectionist US stance, and we don't yet know where the Trump administration is going in the United States, but it will obviously have an impact at some point on the oil price. What I do want to just spend a little time on is the Central Bank Nigeria intervention in the official parallel exchange rates. Now, many British companies have been or have found it difficult to engage with Nigeria for the last 1 to 2 years because of the differential between the official and unofficial exchange rates. British companies have tended to deal with Nigeria on a mix of either open account or letters of credit. Those who've dealt with an open account have actually suffered a bit in terms of trying to get their money returned to the UK. But I think things are changing for the better. Companies like Echo Bank or The Economist, I'm not a trained economist, many economists think that Nigeria's stability would be assisted by a more formal devaluation, so there is no great differential between the official and parallel exchange rate. I don't have a particular view myself, but quite a few economists hope that there will be some resolution of this in the near future, because certainly it has slowed down the enthusiasm of British companies to trade with Nigeria. We do know that the Central Bank has made available foreign currency to the commercial banks, and there was a time when parents in Nigeria were struggling to remit funds to the UK for their children's fees, but that period has gone beyond that now, which is good. But we'll see what happens, and perhaps if Kaido is here later, he can just comment a bit more on an investment banker's view of the future. Just a few words about the UK government perspective. As I said earlier, we're in a Brexit environment. Those of us in the UK who want to promote trade in Nigeria and elsewhere and Africa generally are conscious that we are in competition with other governments like Germany and the Netherlands and so on. The UK government maintains, if you like, three strands of funding in relation to international trade investment. One is DFID, one is Department for International Trade, one is Foreign Commonwealth Office. That rather distinguishes us from our competitor countries like Netherlands, where I think same sort of one government department that tends to coordinate international trade activity. Foreign Commonwealth Office is obviously a diplomatic arm, but it has a lot of money to spend itself under what it calls the Prosperity Fund, over 17 thematic projects, including, as we've just been hearing, ease of doing business. So that is a high priority for the British government in helping to promote trade internationally. Now, quite recently, if you were to ask the Department for International Trade what its focus is going to be, you would probably hear them talk about value. These tend to be high-value strategic projects, large infrastructure projects, and so on. Now, for Nigeria, their perspective is that agro-allied energy, oil and gas, infrastructure and technology is where the UK government will be focusing its energies and encouraging UK companies to do so. However, I say however, it's not a but, it's more an additional observation. I know from speaking to Nigerians and to elements of the Nigerian government that there can be a different perspective, additional perspective. So there are some sectors which the Nigerian government and private sector would like to look at. One is aviation, one is export supply chains, mining, which we talked about yesterday, real estate, steel production, and technology. Just a few words about real estate. I don't pretend any great knowledge in this area. My colleagues in the delegation from Nigeria certainly know a bit more about it than I do. But it is interesting to quote at UK events some of the sizable projects which are taking place in Nigeria, particularly Echo Atlantic City. People here don't have much of a comprehension of the size of these projects, but that project covers 10 square miles. Will have something like 250,000 inhabitants, which is the equivalent of one of those middle-sized towns in the UK, and a daily commuting of something like 150,000. So these are substantial projects in their own right. I believe, I'm told, that there is no British contractor evident in this particular project, which is, I think, a bit of an omission. So those of you who are interested in construction, please talk to my colleagues from Lagos. There are definitely opportunities in this this area. Now, this is a slide produced by Fidelity Bank at the end of last year. It's headed up Not All Doom, so this is from a Nigerian perspective. Now, this is all to do with promoting exports from Nigeria, and banks such as Fidelity Bank are quite keen, indeed very keen, to assist Nigerian companies. This is in line with Nigerian government import substitution strategy, which many of us in the UK would agree with. I myself spent quite some time in Nigeria looking at the agriculture supply chain. We are interested as a chamber, NBCC, in what we call the Export Nigeria project. So we would like to actively assist Nigerian companies in the agriculture and food sector growth area to add value to their trades and to assist them in the UK and indeed in the EU generally to find markets for their products. And of course it isn't just agriculture, you've got mining products and others. We have a list of some activities that UK members take part in. It's quite a long list. I won't go into too much detail. I will mention technology though as a growing area. Many of the Nigerians of diaspora I meet in the UK are involved in technology. We are hoping to take a trade mission to Nigeria, possibly in November, in partnership with one Chamber of Commerce. We know that technology resonates both here and in Nigeria, so we're almost certain that technology will be one of the sectors we will be trying to promote. I'm always interested in talking to other British companies here to get their own ideas about mission activity to Nigeria. I put this up just to show the type of activity, which isn't always London-centred. A couple of years ago, we had a trade mission from Nigeria. We took to Nottingham. It had a creative industry element to it, so we visited the Nottingham Trent University School of Art and Design, which is in the top three School of Art fashions in the UK.
I think the delegates that came to Nottingham were quite surprised at their level of expertise, but I'm slightly a biasedist, I have to admit, because I'm based in the Midlands, where you do get quite a wide range of manufacturing, processing companies, and those are the ones we know that will be interested in Africa. So I mentioned creative industry because it's one that's often neglected. There's a lot of economic activity between the UK and Nigeria in the creative industry. And I put this slide up as a complete contrast. This is what we would call low technology, paint processing. One of our members in Derbyshire processes paint. They are interested in setting up in Nigeria, not just to supply the domestic market, but actually to re-export. They have already operation in Zambia, they're looking at Senegal, they're talking to Ghana as well. But really Nigeria ought to be their location of choice. It's low technology, but it's labour intensive. But they see Nigeria as a hub to re-export around West Africa, of course, but also as far away as the Middle East and possibly even in the Far East. And it's surprising to note that these products are competitive, even at that level. So that was a very quick run through, ladies and gentlemen, of just a UK perspective of where we think we can help British companies. Our job is to de-risk the engagement with Nigeria as far as we can. So thank you for your time.
Thank you very much again, James, for the presentation, and we'll be happy to circulate that as well. So our final speaker before we have a Q&A session, where we'll invite all three speakers back, is Mr. Chris Gunning from Intertech. Chris, yes.
Hello, good morning ladies and gentlemen. Firstly, just like to say welcome to those that have come over from Nigeria. You seem to have brought the weather with you. It's been beautiful for the last couple of days. Pretty terrible last week. My name is Christopher Gunning. I work for a company called Intertech. A lot of people wouldn't have actually heard of who Intertech are. We're actually a total quality assurance company. We have offices in Nigeria, one in Lagos and also one in Abuja, I believe. And our job is to help facilitate trade between any country in the world. We are on the FTSE 100 and we have offices in pretty much every country in the world. What we do is we help with products. So if you are exporting any goods from UK into Nigeria, or if you are from Nigeria and you're looking to trade with the UK and bring in products to increase, whether it's for agriculture, for mining or anything like that, we help ensure that the products meet the regulations of the Nigerian government. We are accredited by the Nigerian government to ensure that any products going into Nigeria pass their standards and meet their standards so that they can get through the customs. It's called the SONCAP program, something some of you may have heard of, some of you may not. It's the Standards Organisation of Nigeria. Now, whether or not you're here from a UK perspective, looking to trade with Nigeria, or from the other side, you're from Nigeria and looking to get investment from the UK, or whether you're looking to find a partner in the UK, you may need some support with any products that you are sending into Nigeria. So all my job really is to do is to help educate any exporters or importers and facilitate that trade to make sure that you don't come a cropper and get your goods stuck into customs. I think the first gentleman, Emenike, he gave a really good story and it was very interesting. I think about 10 years ago was when the agreement with the government came into place from with Intertech, and think that's a key moment, because maybe there's a bad reputation for Africa in general, let's be honest. And the Nigerian government have taken a stance on that, and they've said, okay, let's employ a world-renowned testing agency like Intertek to make sure that any goods meet the standards, they're not counterfeit, they're not unsafe, that they're okay for our people to, if they're consumer goods or if they're going to be used for heavy machinery, that they meet the standards that are needed to be safe in our country. So they employed us to do that, and we've been working with them now for, I believe, 10 plus years in ensuring that the goods meet the standards. Now, I was going to bring a presentation along, but I don't believe in death by PowerPoint, so I could sit here all day and tell you exactly how you need to run through and get your products into Nigeria. But the best thing I would say is for those that are interested in trading with Nigeria or bringing in goods into Nigeria, is ask James or Nimisi for my contact details or come and have a chat with me. And I can happily meet with you on a one-to-one basis to give you a real in-depth knowledge on your field. Because again, it covers all sectors. Whether or not you're bringing in this microphone, this screen here, as I say, oil and gas, a clock, glass, anything, you will or may need to have your goods certified. If you need some help with the testing side of things, then we have laboratories. We have over 1,000 laboratories worldwide where we are able to potentially help and assist or direct you. And that's really about it. I don't want to take up too much of your time, because I'm sure you're looking forward to some coffee. We've had two great speakers already. So all I'd say is thank you very much for letting me speak, and please do come and have a chat with me if you want any more information. Thank you very much.
Chris. We're going to, please stay in your seats, the coffee isn't going anywhere. We have an opportunity now to ask our questions, so I'd be grateful if you can, while I put the chairs and things together, think about your questions, please ask them as succinctly as you can, and also I think this is a great opportunity also to create some form of discussion. So if you do have any insights or comments, again, please do offer them, but do keep them clear and to the point. And I'm brave enough to stop you if you go on a bit too long. But anyway, if we could please welcome back our speakers to the front so that they can take your questions. So, James? James? I think I'll take the questions like in twos because I want to keep it fluid. But can we please have our hands up for any questions that we have? Okay.
Good morning. Shalala, where is my name? I'd like to speak to Mr. Mezuriku from the Minister. In terms of getting us to operate in the airports in Nigeria, there are quite a number of licenses that we're required to get things done. We've applied to do some warehousing project at the airport. And just like you said, that the MDAs are beginning to work together as one single entity, that is not happening so much yet. If you apply for a construction permit, you have to be tossing between one agency and the other. For example, we've asked to do the warehouse, and from farm to get the land, you have to go to NCA to go and get another permit. And that's how we've been going back and forth in the last 1 year. I'd be happy if the MDAs are able to work together as one single entity so that we can have speedy approvals for our projects at the airport. Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Tunde Ogunde. let me also join the other Nigerians in appreciating the wonderful work that you are doing for now. It's very encouraging. But there are two things. One, it has to be sustainable. Because the challenge we actually have is, once we have a policy and the visionaire and the people that actually are interested leave the place, the tendency is for the whole thing to crystallize and then you start seeing something going down. The second, which is also very important, but I found out that we are not addressing it. And this is the issue of multiple taxation. And it's not only affecting the people that are coming in for the first time to do business, even people that are already in business. On a daily basis, they are being harassed, either by the state internal revenue services or the federal internal revenue service. And at times, even though we have waivers, that when we have new entrant into the business, we have a free taxation period, and you discover that they will come, and then 5 years after, they begin to harass them. And these are issues probably we need to emphasize and we need to address. And I think that should be part of the second phase of what you are going to address. Thank you.
If you could please respond.
Thank you very much. For the first question about the warehouse, I'll give you my card. Get in touch with me, we'll deal with it. The order, presidential order, has just come up, and as usual, this is take time. But then, one thing we have decided to do, both the minister and all the people that work with him, is to take responsibility. Call me, I will deal with it. True. Thank you very much for the second question. The issue of sustainability, we have no choice, man. Oil prices are down. The days of the buffet is over. There's no way we can move forward unless we begin this. Critical funds will come into Nigeria when we make that environment good for investors. Everybody, I mean, cost of production, you know, every other thing is going up all over the world. So that's the only wind of economic recovery we have. That is for investors to come and invest in Nigeria, take advantage of the basic economic indices that work in our favor and make us again prosperous. The days where we relied on oil are over. Clearly over. Even if we start, I mean, the projections are that within the next 10 years, cars will be moving without any oil. So there are certain things that just deploy because of factors of life. And these things are deploying. So that's what makes it sustainable. On the issue of taxation, it's something we're also working on with all intensity to put an end to multiple taxation and all kinds of harassment. One of the things I never mentioned is that we want to respect agreements. We want to respect policies. We want to say, if we promise this, we'll keep to it. It's going to happen. That's one of the things. We just believe that the international community will believe in us once we begin to respect agreements and policies. And that's what we're going to do. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Are there any more questions or insights?
Good morning. My name is Constance Seki.
I want you to please, the question directed to Mr. Mecca, I want you to please address this issue of TSA. Because currently in Nigeria, before you do any project with any federal establishment, you have to go through, they'll tell you they now use the TSA account, so and they cannot guarantee the project by themselves. Because we have the project in the University of Benin, for instance, and we wanted the school to guarantee the project. But they said because they don't earn their own money, so they have to go to TSA. But now, for them to even write to TSA, they don't even know whether it's to go to CBN or NUC or Ministry of Finance. I think if there is a very good transparency in that part, I think that would really help.
My name is Bratide Bello, Commissioner of Times. I want to commend the efforts of the Minister for the job that has been so well. The points, I want to raise 2 points. The first point is on the last member here, on the issue of taxation. I want to share an experience. We are based in Lagos, and we pay our fee the 5th of every month, we pay for the previous month. The Lagos government tax office have to tell us later, 10th, that we are not paying for the previous month. Whereas we paid a week earlier. And what we got from the office, just sorry, why we not sure that we already paid this money before even the letter, we wrote the letter. That means we're not keeping records. So apart from people that are not keeping records, they are finding work so that I can follow up those who are paying and those who are paying. The second issue is your legal environment. All these things we are doing, investors want to know how will they protect their investments. I read this point yesterday too. If they have issues with their partner in Nigeria, how will they resolve it? The court system in Nigeria is a very long time to get judgment. So I think you should also take this point, your efforts to ensure that the legal system is reformed, at least for those who are wanting to do business, like you can get judgment in time for investment. And the last point is issue of officials. You see, what is happening is that the top officials, the minister, politicians, they are working harsh to do government. What are the things about themselves? That is the area we have to work on. See, they need some sensitization to change their mindset. Because most of them do that, besides they are getting just allowance. That they want every major project, they must find way of having the technical rotation. That will really sensitize them so that they can flow along with the top executives. So that if the business is doing well in Nigeria, they also will benefit, their children will benefit. Nowadays, when you do that time, before you leave, you have jobs waiting for you. But now there's that people able to start seconds to go to job for them. And because of this environment issue too. So I want you to carry along your officials, the lower level officials, so that you can also work along with the government to change the environment for everybody. Thank you.
We're going to take one more question in this round.
Thank you so much for making your time to come and stay with us. A special thank you to the Minister. He was with us at the Financial Times African Summit in October, and I can tell you there were a lot of very positive feedbacks from the business leaders out there. They were impressed with his presentation, the direction he's going, and they wanted him to come back this October. If you can help us relate that message to him to come back this October at that event. Before I share off again, there is this event coming up next week in Norway, where over 35,000 business leaders in the maritime is coming. We have about six ministers we invited. We're doing that in cooperation with the government of Norway. The Minister for Transport is coming there. It will also be nice to see somebody from your team to come use this platform to be able to get your message out to the international community to help to increase your international visibility. But you know, this is very, very hard. Investors are not emotional anymore in making investments. Like you preaching about the ease of doing business. Can you help us make it easier for us? In Rwanda, if you send an email to a minister, in Cameroon, in Ghana, in a day or so, they will get back to you with whatever information and support you need to get things done. Our Nigeria would love it so much to get a very simple thing like access to bankable projects. It's taking a lot of time to get that done. Can you help us with access rankable coaches. Thank you.
Thank you very much. If you'd like to respond, please.
Thank you very much again. Let me start with TSD. TSD is basically a single treasury account. The whole concept was that all government, all MDs will have their accounts with the CBN. And so that we don't have pockets of money hidden all over the place and government cannot execute anything. In fact, we had a situation where government had money all over the banks, and yet government had to borrow from the banks. So it just didn't make sense. So the single treasury account thing was the right thing to do. And I think somebody probably doesn't have enough knowledge with the people you are dealing with, because it's a very straightforward thing. If you need a guarantee, get in touch with the accountant general's office and they will guarantee you, because if the money is there, the money is there. But then if you still have any problem with this, I'll give you my number, call me. You know, we want to help. In any way we can, we want to help. Taxes, we've spoken about that, and I think all the state governments are coming. In fact, Lagos State is online. Your payments are done online, and the receipts are issued online. I'm sure some of you would have experienced that. I know you carry a card. You can go online and check how much you have paid and how much you haven't paid. It's done. Probably people don't have the knowledge of it, but it is done everywhere. You can see everything is clearly transparent. Legal environment. I mean, the vice president, the acting president today, comes from that environment, and everything is being done to bring about reforms. You know, sometimes initially it was done in a very hard way, but that was instructive, so that people would begin to understand that things have to change. And as I said, we don't have a choice anymore. We just don't have a choice. Things are beginning to change, and they will. Civil servants, you'll be amazed. You thoroughly will be amazed, because once you get it right at the top, once leadership is right, everybody will be keen. Everybody will come into the queue and work accordingly. And then the processes we have now, because these days things are so, how would I put it? I mean, anything that happens, the information age has changed so fast that you can get reports out to people as quickly as possible. So we are saying, I mean, we have a whistleblowing policy in Nigeria. Blow the whistle, man. Blow it. Blow it. Anywhere they ask you for anything, report it. Don't waste time. And once people are aware that nobody wants to take nonsense from them anymore, they will up their acts. Financial Times, thank you very much. The minister, anytime, is willing to work with you. We want to get these policies out, we want to get the information out, we want to interact with the investors. We know it's a lifeline. We want to do it. So the minister is willing to work with you. Access to bankable projects. I mean, this is something we are working on. If you check our website, we shut it down after this massive attack all over the world, you know, but it's up again like this, because they were working 100% on it to make sure it's up and running again. But we respond. We are beginning to, everybody's into this new thinking that we need to respond to people, no matter what, we need to respond. We need to interface with the rest of the world. We want to be up and doing, you know. So I can assure you that this will happen. Thank you very much.
Okay. We've got a statement, first of all, from Mr. David Carr.
Curry.
Curry, sorry, thank you. Who is a UK business person who's also had quite a lot of experience
doing business in Nigeria, and I just feel that it'll be very valuable for him to share just very quickly some of his experiences and his knowledge on ease of doing business in Nigeria.
It hasn't always been easy, as I'm sure you can all appreciate. I went out to Nigeria first with British Gas in 2000, looking at LNG plants. So we were heavily involved in Tolmount River, in all of the LNG plants in Nigeria. I then started my own business in Nigeria in 2005. So I reinforce, when you say, oh, how easy is it to do business in Nigeria? As a foreigner, for me, going to CAC, setting up my own business, getting a registration, very simple. Dealing with FIRS, dealing with the Yimang Review, very simple. It was all much simpler in those days. You know, what is the difference now is that there's more work around. There's a hell of a lot more work around now than there ever has been before. And why is that? Because Nigeria has suddenly woken up and realized that you can't get rich quick by everybody being associated with the oil and gas industry, which is what we all thought. We saw all these rich people making millions, and some of them were making billions from oil and gas. And we all wanted to be part of that oil and gas business. So the textile industry suffered, the paper industry suffered, the mining industry suffered. Every industry in Nigeria, when you were the star of Africa, all suffered because of the next disease, known as oil, and the effect it had on the economy. So the oil going down now to $55 a gallon, means that we all have to wake up and get back into what we could do before, which was what we said, what James pointed out, the textile industry, the paper industry, agriculture, phenomenal. We have 177 million people in Nigeria who all need feeding. We still import rice. We import a lot of things. Why do we do it when we've got a homegrown market? When people ask me, where are the opportunities in Nigeria? And I get this asked by Nigerians all the time, and they always say to me, but it's Nigeria, you don't understand the nuances of like Nigeria, you don't understand that 68% of us live in abject poverty. And they make a million and one excuses. The cup is always half empty. But when you look that you need all these things, then it actually presents an opportunity. And the story I always tell is the shoe salesman. Okay? The English sent a shoe salesman to Nigeria in the 1940s. And he went all over the 35 states. He went to Maiduguri, he went to Kano, he went to Katsina, he went to Rivers, Crossroads, he went everywhere. And he came back and he told his boss, there's no scope for shoes out there, because they don't wear shoes in those days. The Chinese shoe salesman boss sent his guy out there. And this Chinese guy went the same route. He went all around Africa, all around Nigeria to the 35 states. And he came back to his boss and said, I cannot believe this opportunity. Nobody's wearing shoes. They all need them. And those are the things that we all look at in Nigeria. We always look at the negative things. Mining, for example. Why are the Chinese so good at going up to Mohammed Amati in the mining cadastre and getting mining licenses? Why? Why is it so easy for them, yet not easy for us? Why is it easy for Tony Alumalo to start an orange juice plant in Enugu? And rather than have all the fruit wasted, he processes it on site. These are all, we just need to think clearer. Not look at the obstacles, and look at the opportunities that exist out there for you. There's a million and one opportunities I can think right now. I've taught multiple entrepreneurship courses in Nigeria. I've taught 6,000 students MBA courses and oil and energy related courses out there. And after this, I guarantee you, they all go out there and majority start their own businesses up. LPG in Nigeria. We don't manufacture bottles in Nigeria. There's not a bottle manufacturing plant out there. Why don't we do it? There's a million and one things. The domestic gas. We don't have a proper domestic gas facility. We have power stations that are supposed to be gas-fired with no gas, and we don't do any joined-up thinking. So now I've been consulting out in Nigeria for 10 years, and I can tell you now, it's time to go from consulting into a position where we can actually implement these things. And if we wake up now, we can actually do it. The price of the oil going down has significantly helped you. If the Dutch disease is over, get back into what you do best. Yeah. But the get rich quick ship has sailed. This is sustainable business. If you want to do the right thing, if you want a sustainable business, a long lasting business, and the business that you can make good money from, then do it. If you think you can get rich quick, and the diaspora are the guilty ones here as well, because they've seen how many people have got rich in Nigeria over the last 20 years, the ship has sailed. But if you do want to use your expertise in what you've gained over these years, and you want to take it to Nigeria and actually do something for the society, do something for Nigeria, build the infrastructure, then there is a wealth of money to be made, and we will all be happier for it, and Nigeria will be a better place for it. Mining, agriculture, technology, infrastructure, roads, there's a wealth of opportunities out there. If you grasp it now, then you'll be ahead of the game.
Thank you.
I want to ask a question of the Minister's representative about foreign exchange policy. Maybe you won't be able to answer it, but I read from a distance the economic policy of the Nigerian government, and to the extent there is continues to be differential between official and parallel rates, what do you think the outcome is likely to be, and in what timescale?
Yeah, I think the government realizes that we just cannot allow this to continue. There was a pushback from the CBN government for a very long time, but it's coming to terms with it, because every time we, as it were, devalued and created policies that helped for FDIs to operate, we found that things went well for the economy. So the CBN governor and all the people, because, I mean, they are all school of thought, all top economics, you know, I'm not an economist, I'm a chartered accountant, but all kinds of economists who are coming up with all kinds of ideas and all that. But right now, the people who are saying it is better for government to devalue and have very little gap, or if there is none at all between the two exchange rates, to operate that kind of regime, that is better for investments, and I think that day is coming very soon. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Well, Mr. Emeka, this is also for you. I'm sorry we're all descending on you, but there's no choice. About exports. Now, we've been talking about diversification of the economy and the need to now go into exports of non-oil products and all sorts of things that are exportable from Nigeria. But the problem has always been the number of regulatory agencies. You know, to go into exports in Nigeria, the regulatory agencies that you need to go through, there's some good vessel. You go through NAFDAC, you go through SONG, you go through weight and measures, you go even NEPC, Export Promotion Commission, you get certification from it. There are so many of them that it becomes so difficult for a newcomer, especially who would like to go into export. What can we do, you know, to reduce all these hurdles and all these bottlenecks that exports are going through to ensure that, yes, we do what we're talking about? We've been talking about export, but then how easy is it? What can you do to assist? And also, when we spoke about this export simulation form, how easy can it be assessed? The experience that I have from a lot of people, I'm the chairman of the export committee of NBCC, and I receive a lot of complaints and lots of reports from those people who would like to do it. Assessing export stimulation fund is a big problem. How can you assist to ensure that we take advantage of all this? Thank you.
Hello, I'm Jimmy Adigley. Thank you for all the work that you're doing. Your initiative is very encouraging. Thank you so much to the gentleman that spoke earlier. Fantastic comments there. I think my question is this, sorry, Mr. Meke, again, I don't know if something maybe you might be aware of or maybe some of the ministers doing. I'm all for trade, import, export, whatever it is that you're doing. But I think for me, what I find really inspiring about the Western world is that, yes, they do, inter-trade and things like that, but they also empower their own people to do their own businesses and to, you know, be entrepreneurs and, you know, and develop their own businesses as well. Nigeria, okay, maybe we are corrupt, but some of which country isn't. But we're very talented people, and it's just like the gentleman said, that there are a wealth of opportunities in there. But what about the people in Nigeria who have businesses, but probably don't have the support from the government? There are no initiatives to encourage their businesses. They also want to be, you know, doing joint partnerships with, you know, countries abroad. You know, maybe I'm not aware of it, but are there initiatives in place to encourage that joint thing? I mean, we've got so much, the unemployment there is ridiculous. You know, but I just think that there's something that's not being tapped there, and I don't want a case where the focus is on the inter-trade, and then we kind of end up with another problem where our own people are left on the sidelines.
Would you say one more question, and then
James, could you respond to that question as well, please? Thank you very much.
I think this is more of an observation, and to just reiterate the point that had been made earlier on about civil servants, and I think the attitude. And I hear you, you know, when you say that once the right one is set at the top, you know, then they will take the cue from there. But I think that it might not always be so, you know. And I think that right now, whilst the government is, because of the political implications, perhaps, of doing a comprehensive review of the civil service, but it's probably needful. You know, because I get the sense, and I could be wrong, I get the sense that a lot of the civil servants are actually waiting. You know, they know that this government is here for 4 years. And the experience has been that a lot of these things are not sustainable. So my suggestion is really a suggestion would be that we should concentrate on actually making sure that the institutions will survive this current reform that we are going through. And the institutions will only survive if the people themselves buy into it. What I see as somebody who engages with them is that there's some resistance, you know. So they will do it when they think that somebody is watching, but really and truly, they need to buy into it. That's my comment.
Thank you. I think experts. Where's the gentleman that asked questions on experts? Okay. Yeah, I think you talked about multiple agencies and all that dealing with exports. I think right now, because of the presidential order right now, just get all your permits from the Nigerian Exports Promotion Council. Everything you need from them right now, you can get it. And, you know, all the efforts that are being made, because you see, one of our critical problems with exports was the issue of standards. You know, standards, you know, and I think the gentleman that spoke about standards, you know, that's one of the things we want to deal with. Once we get it right, because you get things from Nigeria here, and people are saying they come from Ghana, you know, the world is from Nigeria, you know. We get a lot of all over the place. Things have been exported from Nigeria to all over the world, and they are saying it's coming from Benin Republic, they're coming from Ghana, because of standard certification and stuff like that, you know. So, and this is something we are working on. I think it's going to be done very soon. There's a lot of traction that has already gone into it. And I think sooner than later, you will get results on that. And then, guarantee grants, all those grants is working. Get to NEPC. Is truly, truly working. Once you get your permits and everything, it's very, very easy, and you make exports, you get your grants. So it's working right now, and NEPC is really energized to carry out this function. It's working. If not, again, I tell you, with all of my heart, call me. Then, business in Nigeria. I mean, right now there's so much opportunity for young people and everybody who wants to do business in Nigeria. Because, I mean, if Yowande had had the time to expand, because one of our main issues is that, look, we talk about investments. What about
Nigerian investors itself. So it's something that they are very passionate about. And the Bank of Industry, we've just started the new Nigeria Development Bank, you know, all to fund Nigerians to invest in Nigeria. You know, there's Smedan, there's an awesome amount of funds. I can't give you the numbers now, but it's available to help but young people, business people with ideas to invest in Nigeria right now. And then civil servants, I buy into what you say. You know, one of the things that you learn when you get into government is to become humble, you know. And with all humility, I tell you, this is something we are praying and begging God is going to work. You know, we just believe, show the example, show the right way, and believe that it's going to work, you know. And I believe with the presidential order coming out, with all kinds of consequences of wrong action that is going to be, you know, implemented by government against all people who want to sabotage the system, we believe this is going to work. You know, I understand what you say perfectly, and I'm humbled. Thank you very much.
I'd like to respond to the question about unemployment from a UK perspective. I think Nigeria and other countries could learn a bit from the UK's own experience. Some years ago, in the city I was then in, I represented the Chamber of Commerce in what we called the City Regeneration Project, which was directly to address issues on employment and regeneration of certain industries. And we ended up a structure between the community, private sector, government and education. It was uncomfortable at first, but by the end of 5 years, in fact, it worked very well. It was replicated through 17 cities in the UK. And what it did was force these stakeholders to get together. And a fundamental part of that was the education sector training. The government actually didn't have to put in too much money. The private sector leveraged in a lot more money, and that worked. Now, it's not for me to say it would work well in Nigeria, but I do think if it's not already taking place, it's worth looking at. And conversely, in the UK, there's a lot more we can do exporting. Some of you may have heard of the Coal Commission report in 2015. Sir Graham Coal, that was all to address UK's poor export performance. Believe it or not, we're 23 out of 28 in the European Union for export growth, which is a pretty miserable statistic. And that Commission's recommendation was that the Chambers of Commerce should take a central role around the country, almost like a one-stop shop, but engaging with the diaspora, the tertiary education sector, and government generally, and local councils. And we'll wait and see what happens, but I do think Nigeria could take some of the lessons that we've learned here.
Okay, thank you. So we'll take three more.
What I want to say is that a lot that has been said by the minister's representative, as well as Yewade that spoke yesterday, they are more aspirational. So if you want to go to Nigeria, don't go there with a hope and expectation that voila, everything is working perfectly already. They hope to, and they have set timelines, and they are hoping that when those things are implemented fully, you can have the right environment to do business. Change has come, change is ongoing, but we have not reached that destination yet. So let's just try to be cautious in our expectations. I think that the institutional framework that will support what has been espoused is not strengthened yet. You have ministers coming from the private sector with private sector driven ideas quite often, into government, and they meet quite some rot in the system, and they are trying to engraft this very lofty ideas they've got onto a system that it has decayed over the years. It's definitely not going to be right. It's not going to turn out right in the short term. So we would have to, Honorable Minister's representative, we would have to, first of all, spend a lot of time not on the publicity or propagating these new ideas, but to strengthen the institutional frameworks that can support and ensure that by the time the minister's tour of duty is done, the next man comes in and meets a structure that is strengthened, that he can build on, and then with time, we can start to see this as a way of life, a way of doing business. But we're not there yet. So what I think we're doing is we're trying to say, this is what we want to do, and we want you to believe us that it's going to happen. And by the time people walk into the airports, they meet a different experience. All right? Thank you.
My contribution will be twofold: commentary, observation, and question. I'll add to what Ray has said in terms of strengthening institutional structures. Infrastructure should be incorporated in the ease of doing business, because it's a critical factor in terms of power supply, internet, you know, communication, being in transportation, the airport, you know, being able to get from A to B. Yeah? And I'm delighted that you are sitting side by side with James today, because it is critical to feedback, to incorporate the feedback from real businesses into what you're doing in terms of ease of doing business. It's not just the gospel coming from the minister or your team is now listening, and this is a bilateral trade chamber of commerce, you know, in terms of what James said, Britain wanting to export and Nigeria exporting from here. Trying to repatriate money from Nigeria for investors is a big headache. Hybrid College is one of them in terms of NOTAM certificate. You know, we spent a lot of money there, but we can't get it back. You know, we need, the British High Commissioner is working on it, but I don't know the relationship between the federal system, because the states are autonomous. You know, so there are issues in terms of honoring contracts in Nigeria. The federal government needs to look into things that happen in the states as well.
I'm so excited. We actually have a question from our live Facebook. I have to read it at the live Facebook stream. I'll just read it out. So this is from Baba Koshi, and the question is there 24-hour electricity supply in Nigeria? I heard a lot of businesses run on diesel power generators. I think it is difficult for businesses to invest without steady power supply. What about roads, water, etc.? So these are we know the answers, but the interest in Nigeria is really, really growing, and people cannot believe that a country that has the most famous musicians, famous artists, inventors, engineers could have survived and created such excellence. Is there 24-hour power? Are there roads?
Thank you very much. For the gentleman that says that a lot of the things are aspirational, yeah, they're good aspirations. I just want to recall what the other gentleman spoke, who has had about 10 years experience in Nigeria and all that. He said, I love that, because what it means is that the days of nonsense are gone.
the coordinates are right now. It's not as if it's just because you find a man who is like, you know, the coordinates are right because we have no choice. The coordinates are right all over. The oil prices are down. Everything is that. Everything that gave us that comfort in the past to fool around are gone. We have no choice. The consequence of not taking this action is almost death. The number of young people that are coming up is overwhelming. The problems are so stark and real. The coordinates are so much that there's nothing else we can do except get it right. So it's not just right, it's good aspiration, but the implementation is taking place now. And as I said, I'll give you my number, call me anytime. You might call us, or you might say the minister, the president, the vice president, the apostles, but these are people who are prepared to lay down their lives to make sure these things work. It will happen. I can assure you of that. Infrastructure, that's why we love the private sector. Because government thinking right now is that the only way we have ever succeeded is by partnering effectively with private sector. And all the policies that are coming into place is to work together with private sector. We understand, as I said, you get into government, it humbles you. It humbles you big time. Because it could have been, I used to be out there pulling my hair and really screaming about, but you get in and you get humble. And we've come to terms with the fact that we must partner with private sector. What you said about state governments and not giving, we totally agree. You're right. But we start from federal government and say we must be able to keep agreements. We must be able to sustain policies and say what we are passing on to the rest of the world, you can come and you test us on it and it will work. So we're also passing on the same message with state governments. We understand because the dynamic of the whole world is changing. If you don't get into it, the coordinates have changed totally. If you don't get into it, you're left behind. So we have come to that realization and we have said this is the way to go. And most state governments are also coming to that realization. The knowledge base has gone up no matter what happens. So people know things every day. They get information on a daily basis. So people are not comfortable anymore with any type of laxity. People are no more prepared to live with it, even with state. So people are aware. Power supply, as I said, that's the same thing. The Minister for Power, Energy, and so on, every day is being bombarded. The young man has grown very old as a result of this. He's grown. You know, and it's not just talk. There's serious effort too, because people are aware. People are talking, people are, the momentum has taken off and people are moving. So when he says that by 2019 we are doing 25,000 megawatts, believe him, because he has no choice but to deliver on it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay then, we'll have our last question.
Thank you very much for this opportunity. Thank you, Mr. Mehta. This question is for you, the last one. My name is Alex. I work for the Department for International Trade with the agri-tech sector. And Nigeria happens to be one of our high-value campaign markets. And so, regards to trade. So we're supporting UK businesses to export agri-technology to Nigeria. So my question is, I know part of it has been answered, but
What comes to mind is the fact that by 2050, the world population must have grown by over 9 billion, and the only way to sustain increased demand for food is to actually have good practices, farm practices to reduce waste and to increase yield. This year, we're supporting UK businesses to expand their agri-technology to Nigeria. So are there structures, are there systems in place to actually support farm businesses to actually assess this technology, assess in terms of, because this technology are not cheap. So talking about the young people that needs to be employed, I did my first degree in Nigeria, studied agriculture. Quite a lot of people are coming through the institutions being trained in agriculture, but they normally adopt farm practices that are like 10 years behind. So that's where agri-technology comes, to actually encourage young people as they graduate into farming. So what structures, what systems are in place to actually support agri-technology, the uptake of agri-technology in Nigeria, purchasing the technology and actually encouraging these young people to adopt it? Thank you very much.
Well, I don't have all the answers, but I will attempt it. I mean, there's a Bank of Agriculture. The Ministry of Agriculture is very, very passionate about what you talked about. We understand how critical agriculture is, you know. And over the last year, we made a tremendous growth in the area of rice. Remember, that's what got my friend Frank into trouble. But now we have expanded. I mean, a lot of states are producing rice. We believe that by next year, Nigeria will be complete, won't import any rice anymore. And a whole lot of other products. And we also expect that as we produce, because our major problem really is what do we do? How do we improve discipline? How do we improve what we produce? And how do we even store them? You know, you come to Nigeria today, we're just getting to the end of the mango season, you know, you'd be amazed at the amount of mangoes all over the place. I feel sorry for the poor guys. It's all over the place. You know, so we are beginning to realize that we need to do something else. And processing factories are coming up, companies are setting up, people are coming to say, oh, we need to process this thing and preserve it for a longer time and all that. So those things are beginning to take place. As I said, the coordinates right now are right. They are right. And anybody you know, come to Nigeria. There's a place. Thank you very much.
I spent some time looking at agricultural supply chains. We did actually do an outreach mission in 2015 with DIT on agri-tech. So if you can speak afterwards, I can perhaps give you some pointers.
Thank you very much. Please, if you could show your appreciation. Thank you. I really enjoyed that session, and I'm very grateful to the speakers for the information they provide and the generosity that they've shown. And I'm also very grateful to yourselves for your engaging questions, your insights, and we hope to continue relationships with yourselves. James, who's here, is the chair for the Nigerian British Chamber of Commerce UK Network. So please do come to us for information about joining the chamber and or any other events that we host. I'm just going to do a few things because we've actually got Adele. Sorry, if you'd like to take... Sorry, thank you. Just a few things. So who's ever's travelling with us to Liverpool? Thank you very much. Who's coming? The train is going to be leaving at 7 minutes past two. So at 1 o'clock exactly, can we meet in the courtyard so that we can make our way to the train station? We've got your tickets and we'll get on the train together. But yeah, please, if you could meet at the courtyard at 1 o'clock. I know there was a few people that wanted one-to-one, so if you could please come to the window over there and then we can set those up for you.
We've got this room until 1 o'clock. Please use it to network, to engage, to share contact. There's a lot of drinks, you know, coffee and everything. So please feel welcome. Anyway, thank you very much again for taking part, and we hope to host you again in the near future. Thank you very much.
Wow, wow, wow. I'm sure those of you that have been following the event have enjoyed it as much as I've enjoyed it myself. The opportunities are there for us to take advantage of. I've said it so many times, you can't just sit down without taking action plan. So it is up to individual to decide, yes, Baba Koshi, you might want to wait to 2019, but that might be too late. You know, you might want to start up now, and then later on, you know, the electricity will become 24 hours. I'm sure you could remember that the United Kingdom was not as it is in terms of electricity years back, but improvement and improvement started coming in. And they've said it all, you know, there's so much opportunity. I will see if I can grab someone else to talk to you while, you know, we're still in there in this building. Again, as usual, this was brought to you live by Niger Diaspora. We're coming again. This weekend is a very busy weekend. As long as we're aware of your event, we will bring it live to you. For those of you that don't want to come out, or those of you that are probably, you know, somewhere, you know, in Nigeria, I've seen a lot of people watching from Nigeria, from South Africa, from, you know, Ghana. You know, this is the whole idea, you know, to try and do something different, you know, from the others. And that's the reason why we try to bring the transmitting live to you, as usual. Again, there's so many businesses here that I'm going to collect some of their information. You might want to inbox me, and I'll be able to send that to you. As usual, my name is Olayomi Koike. I'm going to move the camera around to see if we can get someone to speak to you in regard to what has happened today.
So did you just hear about the event, or
I got email.
Oh, okay, so you're not
there. I was there last night.
Oh, wait.
At the High Commission.
Oh, fantastic. Yeah. Oh, good. So, I'm happy.
Yeah.
That's great.
So
what's your name? Okay, email me directly. Like, because you know the info.
Yeah.
So just say, ask for Yemisi.
Yemisi, okay.
Okay, and email. That was great. Thank you.
My pleasure.
I'm happy. We'll make sure that we...
And what I'll do, I'll send you a video copy of this.
Yes, exactly. But we'll make sure that we share it with our people as well.
That's
thank
okay.
you.
You're welcome. I'm still trying to see if we can get someone to speak to you. Maybe I might get, you know, 1 minute. At least I should get one person to talk to you. Hello, sir. I'm Olayomi Koike, Niger Diaspora. Not too bad. I just want you to talk to the audience that are watching on Facebook and give them one or two reasons why it's the right time for them to come on now and add their value and their expertise that they acquired in the United Kingdom. So that's what I want you to do now. When you're ready.
Okay. Yeah. Hi. Okay. You know, I was
talked about the Singapore Parliament thing, and one of the goals to make an even part work is advertisement. Yeah? So is that what you guys do?
Yes.
Okay, fine. The goal is to get a role. Yes, make noise about it, creates a whole lot of noise.
Well, the minister, the person I was going to bring to you is still a little bit busy. As you can see, you know, there's so much happening. Networking is taking place now. People are trying to
network.
Maybe you might want to speak to my audience. Let me put my camera around. You just tell us where you are.
Okay, my name is Vasily Devil.
Okay.
Okay. I'm a council member of the Yorkshire Commons. I'm also chairman of the MSM committee. We are here to look for each company that have interest in investing in Nigeria and also have something to add on. We link them up and also link them up with all the MSMEs in the agrarian industry. Nigeria now is ripe for business investments. The atmosphere is good. The government is doing their best to improve the ease of business in Nigeria and also through their brutal infrastructure. So we are inviting each company here to come and join hands with the Nigerian counterparts to have access to $180 million people. The biggest ones in Africa are from Nigeria, you can enter the other countries like the Republic, Ghana, Togo. So we are about to
Have you got your card? So yes. I'll be able to push that onto our media later on when I get back.
Yes.
Thank you very much, okay. Sir. Thank you. Wow. As you can see, what is actually taking place now is that people are now trying to do a little bit of network. I've already got two information that I'll be bringing back to you. There's a team park that is coming to Nigeria, something similar to Disneyland. I'm gonna bring, I'll allow you to speak to one of the brain behind it. I want you to speak in a minute to those that about what you've said in terms of the theme park and how we should be expecting that to come in, you know, very soon. I'm going to turn the camera around and I let you go. Yeah. And Niger Diaspora has already going to be part of the media team that will be bringing this to you when the time comes. Niger Diaspora is already going to be engaging, you know, with the theme park, and all those information will be coming to you very soon. Again, as usual, my name is Olayomi Boyke. I hope you've enjoyed it as much as I've enjoyed it. I need to take a little bit of time now and build a little bit of network. Again, if you're not there, you're not there. But the most important thing is take advantage. Nigeria is a country that is growing, and it's growing very, very fast, and we must all take advantage of it. Thank you very much once again for those that have joined me, and I hope to be back.
Okay, okay, you got something to tell us? May I have something to tell us?
Yes, not really. Tell us. Okay. My name is Jessica.
Okay.
I'm from the Nigerian Chamber of Commerce in Nigeria.
Okay.
The communications and business service executive for them.
Okay.
And if
people want to know more about the NBBC, where should NBBC. They be going?
Okay, so you just visit us, go to our website at www.nbbc.org.ng, or you can send us an email to info@nbbc.org.ng.
Okay.
Yeah, you can also follow us on Instagram, Twitter. Okay.
I'm gonna bring that to you. The details that she's giving me, she's gonna give me a card.
Yeah,
I'm gonna put her back onto the social media. The most important thing is all happening in Nigeria. It's a big opportunity, and we must all connect, and that is the reason why MBBC is here. They are on their way to Liverpool. I'm very sorry, I'm not going to Liverpool, and I've got so much to do, but they are on their way to Liverpool. It's a 6 days event. This took place last year. I was at the one you did last year, the High Commission. They're back again this year. You must connect. That is the most important thing. Thank you very much for watching. Again, again, and again, Olayomi Koike. Thank you to everyone that have watched, and I hope you've enjoyed it as much as I've enjoyed it. Take care and have a good afternoon. Bye for now.